Korea's Foreign Minister Ri Yong-ho said Monday the United States has declared war on his country.
Given the fact that this comes from someone who is currently holding the seat of United States presidency, this is clearly a declaration of war.
Ri said we will have every right to take countermeasures, including the right to shoot down the United States strategic bombers, even when they are not yet inside the airspace border of our country.
The flyovers by U.S. warplanes off North Korea's east coast over the weekend were an agreed move between South Korea and the United States. Two B-1B Lancer bombers from Anderson Air Force Base in Guam and six F-15C air superiority fighter jets from Okinawa's Kadena Air Base flew in international airspace off North Korea's east coast for approximately 3 hours from Saturday night until early Sunday morning. That was the farthest north of the demilitarized zone any U.S. fighter or bomber jet has flown in the 21st century. As South Korean President Moon Jae-in abruptly opened the National Security Council meeting on Sunday, many had speculated the U.S. hadn't notified South Korea of the flyovers beforehand. But Seoul's presidential office says the flyovers were reported in real time to President Moon Jae-in, who was then in New York for the U.N. General Assembly. Reacting to the recent demonstration, China's English state media The Global Times reported that China won't allow any provocation to regional security. The agency reported that the possibility of Washington taking extreme measures against Pyongyang is rising and that China has to be ready for a possible war.
Now North Korea on notice. President Trump appearing ready to take action against the rogue regime at this hour, tweeting this, quote, "Just heard Foreign Minister of North Korea speak at the UN. If he echoes thoughts of Little Rocket Man, they won't be around much longer. But are Americans ready for military action?"
Tensions are rising on the Korean Peninsula with recent flyovers as well as an exchange of tough rhetoric between the leaders of the U.S. and North Korea. But experts here believe this may not be all.
"We have to focus on the fact that the format of the United States armed protest has completely changed. Bombers flew towards the north, and jets for assistance like rescue plans also joined the flyovers. This means the U.S. assumed a military attack against North Korea and aimed to show that it can come up with even stronger military demonstrations depending on Pyongyang's future provocations."
Speculation is rising in regards to what the U.S. will show next, especially with the South Korea-U.S. joint exercise coming up next month. The drill will involve the nuclear-powered supercarrier USS Ronald Reagan, Tomahawk missiles, and the Aegis combat system.
"And so, yeah, it's edgy and it's a bit scary, but this has to be done. At least in some way, he has to be put in his place."
"Right. And right now, if you ask the American people about this, because he does have nuclear weapons, they were asked, and they said 58% favor using diplomatic efforts first, 35% are opposed to doing it. We're at the point now, though, Terry, is whoever was the 45th president would be dealing the same way. But some in the State Department are worried about the bellicose tone of the president."
On Monday, the White House Press Secretary Sarah Sanders said, "We've not declared war on North Korea." She said the suggestion is absurd.
"North Korea's foreign minister said that President Trump had declared war on North Korea and that it reserves the right to take countermeasures, including shooting down U.S. aircraft. Does the White House view President Trump's comments at the U.N. as a declaration of war?"
"Not at all. We've not declared war on North Korea, and frankly, the suggestion of that is absurd."
"What is the White House's reaction to North Korea's threat to shoot down U.S. aircraft, even if it's not in their airspace?"
It's never appropriate for a country to shoot down another country's aircraft when it's over international waters. Our goal is still the same. We continue to seek the peaceful denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. That's our focus. Doing that through both the most maximum economic and diplomatic pressures as possible at this point."
"Someone, whoever was in charge right now, would have to deal with this. I think President Trump's at least strong stance is the right way to go, because it's gotten us nothing to this point. You know, we've placated them, we've played games with them, and we've got nothing for it except more threats to us and, of course, our allies, which are very important to us, and we can't discount that. So ignore the talk. I tell people in the U.S., please just ignore the talk and just watch what the president does. More importantly, watch what our enemies do in response to him. That's what really matters.
Air-to-ground strikes against what would be nuclear and missile facilities and the regime's leadership during wartime.
Tension between the United States and North Korea remained high Sunday as inflammatory rhetoric from both nations continues to be exchanged following harsh speeches last week in New York at the United Nations General Assembly. Neighboring countries said a small earthquake that hit North Korea Saturday near the country's nuclear test site was likely a natural tremor and not a nuclear explosion. The U.S. Geological Survey, however, said it could not confirm whether the seismic activity was man-made or natural. Following the tremor, U.S. B-1B bombers escorted by Air Force fighter jets flew in international airspace off the coast of North Korea in a clear demonstration of force. The Carl Vinson aircraft carrier led one of two carrier strike groups that conducted joint exercises with South Korea and Japan earlier this year. Pyongyang responded with the release of propaganda videos showing U.S. planes and an aircraft carrier under simulated attack. U.S. officials were more restrained with their words Sunday. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin, speaking on ABC's This Week, repeated the insistence that all options, including military force, remain on the table.
Senator, I think everyone hopes that the diplomatic efforts will be successful, but I want to ask you about the military side. You're a member of the Armed Services Committee. There's a lot of talk among defense analysts about the need for a crash program to develop what are described as boost phase interceptors that could take out North Korean missiles in the first 2 minutes of their launch. It's an interesting idea. Is that something you think that we should be thinking about spending money on to make that happen quickly?
Yes, but I will also tell you that there are a number of opportunities that we have. We do have some in place today. I will also share with you that there are always new programs under development, some in different phases. But most certainly North Korea has been identified as a problem child for the rest of the world for some time now. We recognize that long term we have to have the ability to defensively protect ourselves and our allies. That takes several different forms. First part is being able to identify when a launch actually occurs as soon as possible. Second of all, to be able to intercept in an appropriate fashion. And then finally, to be able to actually make the hit or the kill on the targeted vehicle, all of which not only do we have some capability of today, but we most certainly have to improve long term. You've seen that in terms of Iron Dome in Israel, which we've participated in, David Sling, and so forth. Those are ongoing processes, all of which can help us with North Korea. You have to understand, though, none of those are absolutely perfect. Diplomacy is still appropriate. Economic sanctions are still the best. Let's do everything we can not to get into a fighting war. But I will say this. If we get into a fighting war, it probably means the end of North Korea.
This week, the president signed an executive order that allowed me to issue the most strong sanctions that have ever been done. I can cut off financial institutions anywhere in the world that support North Korea. And the military is one form, economics is another form, and the president will pursue all the options. I think it's unbelievable that the government in North Korea said this week that they may test a hydrogen bomb above the Pacific Ocean. That's something that everyone in the world should be completely put off on and unify against.
Mnuchin said while the United States has many options in dealing with North Korea's nuclear and missile programs, he downplayed the likelihood of nuclear war. Mnuchin stressed U.S. actions are in response to North Korean provocations and not about a personal spat between North Korean leader Kim Jong-un and President Donald Trump.
This is not about personalities. This is not personal. This is about someone who's testing nuclear weapons, a hydrogen bomb that was dramatically bigger than any bomb that's been used. This is about sending ballistic missiles across Japan's airspace. These things are not going to be continued to be allowed.
Still, some leading Republicans voiced hope President Trump will tone down his comments, including Kentucky Senator Rand Paul speaking on NBC's Meet the Press.
is currently holding the seat of United States presidency. This is clearly a declaration of war.
Ri said we will have every right to take countermeasures, including
North Korea's east coast over the weekend, or an agreed move between South Korea and the United States. Two B-1B Lancer bombers from Anderson Air Force Base in Guam and six F-15C air
The right to shoot down the United States strategic bombers, even when they are not yet inside the airspace border of our country.
The flyovers by U.S. warplanes off
North Korea's Foreign Minister Ri Yong-ho said Monday the United States has declared war on his country.
Given the fact that this comes from someone who